Hi and welcome! Have you ever thought about offering adjustable font sizes to your players, but trying to figure out how to implement it has you stumped? Offering to adjust the font size in your game is a great way to increase its accessibility. So let's have a look at how to achieve this goal. In TextMeshPro, there is actually a super useful setting to use in this case. Overflow mode, page. In this tutorial, we will have a look at how that works, how to utilize it, and how to offer adjustable font sizes to our players as well. Just like in a book, your long text will be divided up into multiple parts, thus pages. Each will be as long as possible to fill the space of your text box. You can increase the page count directly in this box to preview it, but of course we can change the current page by code as well. This is the whole dialogue for this scene. Both characters are being awfully wordy for the sake of showing off the overflow setting. There is a graphic for the text box itself, and a button to jump to the next page of the text box. If the whole text fits inside the box, or the overflow setting is not set to page, it will be hidden. This would probably be most useful for UI text like in tooltips or menus or mission briefings, where the player might need some visual info if there is more text available. Let's have a look at the code. We will start with a reference to our text box, which we set in Awake. To make sure we will always have a TMP text available to find, let's add a required component of type TMP text at the top as well. Next up are the two parts of the story we want to display. I'll be using two simple strings for this example, like this. To be able to easily switch from one to the other, I'll create a list of entries to toggle through as well. I'll explain why in a moment. To keep track of which string we are currently displaying, we need an index for it. The next two lines are the most important. Current text pages refers to the page count our current text needs to be displayed in full. Current page references the page we display currently. To scroll through the pages, we will write a method called displayNextPage. Inside, we will check if our current page is less than the currently needed amount of pages. If it is, we will increment the page to display. This will open the next page of our multi-page text box. Else, we will increment our text index to switch to the next text to display. Just for the sake of this tutorial, I will also add a check if the index is higher than the amount of strings in my list, in which case I will reset it back to zero. This way, I can scroll through my view text indefinitely. And lastly, we need to set the text of our text box to the correct string and reset the page to display back to 1. It works just like a normal pagination in a book, so it doesn't start with 0, but with 1. I would like to test the functionality in editor mode. To achieve it, you can just add context menu above the method. If you do, you can right-click the component and pick the method from the drop-down. If you have Odin Inspector installed, just add a button instead. Both work the same. I just like the Odin way a lot more. Back in the editor, we need to attach the script to our text box and add our contents. Since Awake won't be called in the editor, I'll add the reference to the TMP text by hand. Let's give it a try. As you can see in our page count and the text to be displayed, it correctly scrolls through the pages and only loads the next chunk of the story once we reach the end. Our next step will be that our player can adjust the font size of our text box. I highly recommend using TextMeshPro's text styles for this instead of using the small font size down here. If you have seen previous videos of my channel, you will probably already know what I am talking about. But since I guess most of you are new here, TextMeshPro offers something called text styles. They work a bit like formatting texts in CSS with things like fonts to use, font sizes, colors, but also come with options for materials, for example. They are not terribly complex, but with a bit of practice will speed up your typographic workflow in Unity by a lot and make it easier to modify your typography and the future of your project. Watch this 7-minute video to get a good overview of how styles work. The following will make a lot more sense if you do. Let's create a very simple style for this use case. I want to use a dedicated font with this name for my dialog box and give it an initial font size as well as color. Do not forget to set your text box's style to this newly created one, and if you follow along, save your TMP font file in the TextMeshPro Resources Fonts and Materials folder as well. If I change the number in the style, you can see how it changes the font size. Problem is, we can't straightforwardly change these style tags and contents outside of the editor, which is a super bummer. So, this is why for the next part, we are going to be utilizing a tiny regex to look for and change our desired font size, as well as change the values inside our style sheet by using reflection. First, we have a private variable called stylesheet. This here is used to set the stylesheet value to the default stylesheet of the TextMeshPro settings you set in Edit, Project Settings, TextMeshPro, Settings, Default Stylesheet. We need to work with strings to look for the name of the style we want to modify. And here, we have a public static action, which takes in a string parameter. We use it to send a message to other objects once we modified the contents of the text style. Next up, we have a public method called changeFontSize, which takes in a single float parameter. To utilize it, I will be using a simple slider with a minimum value of 40 and a maximum value of 80. Make sure your numbers are all integers. Being on a German system meant that I get comma values from floats, which TextMeshPro can't understand. Using whole font sizes is usually a good way to go anyway. This line retrieves the TMP style associated with the style name that we set. If our style is null, we are going to log an error message to the console and exit the method. Since this system is based around strings, having a typo is a usual case for problems, so it helps to get notified. This line creates a regular expression that matches a string with the pattern of size, followed by one or more digits, and then ends with the right side of the pointy brackets. It's basically a pattern we will be looking for. In our super simple style, we could probably just get away with looking for the digits themselves, but in more intricate styles, adding the whole tag makes it a lot more robust. This line creates a new string variable called modified opening definition, which uses the regular expression we created above to replace the font size value in the opening definition of the style with a new font size value. And here, we are using so-called reflection to get the opening definition field of the TMP style object. This field contains the opening tags of the text style. As you can see here, inside the TMP style class, the opening definition is set to private. By gaining access like this through reflection, we basically force our way in because we can't do it any other way. I would love for there to be another way. Reflection provides us with a couple of methods which lets us access objects' members, even the private ones. When we use reflection to access an object's private field, we need to provide an instance of the object so that it knows which object's field to access. In this case, we are providing an instance of the TMP style object whose opening definition field we want to modify. To do this, we use the getField method, hand it the field's name and specify that it's neither public nor static. If we successfully retrieve the M opening definition field information, we set the value of that field to our modified opening tag. And we need to apply the changes that we just made to the style, of course. And finally, we are using the action we created earlier to send a message to other objects in the game that the text style has been updated, passing in the name of the style. Let's add it as a new component to our slider and let the method be called every time we move the handle. At this point, this isn't working yet because our text box is not being notified about the updated style. A last short piece of code will fix it. Create another monobehavior, make sure it will always have a TMP text to work with, and get the reference in awake. In onEnable, subscribe to our previously created action, and make sure to unsubscribe in onDisable as well. UpdateTextStyle takes a string parameter and will check if the text box's text style's name is the same as it is being given. If it is, we will reapply the style it is already set to, which will update the visuals of our box. And then because if we change our font size and it suddenly requires less pages, we might be stuck with an empty text container. In this case, we check if we are currently over the current text's needed page count, and if we are, we set it to the last page. Just for testing purposes, I will throw in a debug.log which will give us a few infos on the needed and current page count. And this is how our complete system looks and works now. I also updated the typewriter effect we created a few tutorials ago to be able to use the page overflow method. You can find that code as well as the code for this tutorial on my GitHub linked below. I hope you enjoyed the video. Please like it if you did and subscribe. Seeing the subscriber count go up makes me want to continue creating videos. I hope you have a great week. See you next time!